Holy Father, we pray that as you first inspired this word by your Spirit, Lord, that you would enlighten us by the presence of the same Spirit. May he work among us and in us so that we might hear you, hear your voice in the reading of your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to share with you a sort of meditation, really, on Romans chapter 5. Letter to the Romans chapter 5. If you've got one of your church Bibles, it's on page 1753. 1753, Romans 5. My theme tonight is simply reigning in life, reigning in life. Because that phrase, it talks about us who receive the gift of righteousness, reigning in life through Jesus Christ. And this talk has grown out of me just trying to ask, what on earth does that mean, to reign in life? So let's read from Romans chapter 5, verse 12 onwards. He's been talking about how Jesus has not just mended the damage done by Adam, but actually put us in a better place. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men because of sin. For before the law was given, sin was in the world, but sin is not taken into account when there's no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command as Adam did, who was a pattern of the one to come. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Again, the gift of God is not like the result of the one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Reigning in life. You might think that if death reigns as a result of what Adam does, then life will reign as a result of what Jesus does. That would be neat and tidy. Death through Adam, life through Jesus. And I've heard quite a few talks that say that, and that's true. But that's not what the apostle says. He says death reigned, but not that later life will reign. He turns it around. We reign in life. Death ruled over us, but we shall rule in life. And that got me thinking. It says that Adam was a pattern of Jesus. And what I think that means is that, of course, Jesus is the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. When God said, let there be light, he knew very well that by saying, let there be light, he was also saying, let Jesus die for the sin of the world. God's plan was always, always to lead us to a position where in the future we will reign in life. This is important. Because it is not just that everything was going swimmingly, Adam blew it, and so Jesus had to sort out mess. Something deeper is going on here. It has always been God's intention to bring about a people who are redeemed by the blood of Jesus, a people who will reign in life. We are meant to rule, and there's been no collusion between me and Henry tonight, but the passage he shows from Psalms, is it 115? And the songs we've chosen have already looked at this idea that we are being elevated, in a sense, past Adam. We are being elevated to a more wonderful condition than the condition Adam's in. There's an old Isaac Watts thing that says that in Jesus Christ, the tribes of Adam boast more than their father lost. And that's really what I'm saying here now. That what Adam did is has not just been mended. It's not just that Jesus has picked up a stitch that was dropped. What is actually happening is something more wonderful. It is not just that we will have eternal life back. It is that we shall reign. We shall rule in that eternal life. I don't know if you've ever asked yourself, what am I going to do in the resurrection? Have you ever asked yourself that question? What am I going to do? In our house group, we play a game which is resurrection redundancy. Okay, resurrection redundancy is a good little game to play amongst your friends. What jobs will be redundant in the resurrection? And what jobs are we still likely to do? Okay, do you want to have a go? Do you want to play the game for a minute? Resurrection redundancy. What jobs will not be required in the resurrection?
Mothers.
Really? Okay. I'm going to think about that. I think certainly childbirth is something you can pass on in the resurrection. Although there might be something like mothering going on. I don't know about that. I'm not clever enough to know to give you a straight answer. I'm fairly confident that we won't need accountants in the resurrection. So lucky Neville's changed his job. And I'm pretty sure we won't need policemen. I think locksmiths probably will have to find a new job in the resurrection. Once you start thinking in terms of what would a world be like where human beings are wonderful and pure and honest and true. And actually, some of the jobs we think probably aren't so important might still be there. An honest bricklayer might still have some bricklaying to do. Certainly, the New Jerusalem sounds like it's going to have plenty of room for development. We might find that musicians are still required in the resurrection. It's kind of an interesting idea, isn't it? But the most important thing, the one thing I know that we shall do in the resurrection is this. We shall reign with Jesus Christ. That is the testimony of Scripture. It's almost the only thing we're told about what we'll actually be doing in the resurrection world. We shall rule with Jesus Christ. I've just finished yet another Bible study in the book of Revelation, and that idea comes up half a dozen times. You will sit with Christ. That's what that meant in the passage we read about being seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. Jesus is not just sat in any old place in the heavenly realms. Jesus is sat on the throne. And if you're going to sit with Christ, you are sitting with Christ. Even now, we are beginning to reign with Jesus. And I think that's a lot of what Romans 5 is saying. Death ruled over us, but we are beginning to reign in life through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So what went wrong in the garden? What goes wrong in the story of Adam and Eve? God placed them in a rather wonderful position. He made them his stewards, his viceroys. Adam and Eve had a little patch, a garden that they were meant to rule over. And that rule was meant to extend, I believe, through the whole earth eventually. They were to tame the earth, to subdue it, to bring it under their government, and they in turn were the image of God. And therefore, in relation to the animals and the plants, and in relation to all of creation, they were to rule. But what happened was that they gave up that wonderful position that they were in. Adam was meant to teach his wife, and they were meant to rule over the animals, including that snake. But what happened was that they gave up that position by doing what the snake suggested. Adam gave up his position by doing what his wife told him to do. There was a complete reversal. They disobeyed God, and they rejected God's order. And so they had to be made subject to death. They were not meant to die. I don't know if you ever thought about this, but death is just wrong for people. I know some people like to say death is normal, death is natural. Now I agree that with the animals and the plants, that is probably the case. I know some people grieve over their budgies, but basically that's only because they project onto the budgie a little bit of their humanity. But for the case of human beings, death is a tragedy and it is dishonourable. And so, for instance, we read in 1 Corinthians 15 that this body, when it dies, is sown in dishonour. It is sown in shame. The death of human beings shows that we've lost our proper position. We were not meant to die. But because Adam sinned, death entered the world, and now we are all subjects of the ruler, death. Death reigns over us. It was not meant to reign over us. We were meant to be the lords of God's good creation, the lords and ladies, and instead we have become subject to death. We're also meant to become subject to our own lower natures. We have become subject to our own uncontrollable instincts and desires as well. But in Romans, the main thing is that death has ruled ever since Adam. But what Jesus has done is not like what Adam did. Adam's failure meant that you and I are born as subjects of death. So as soon as we're born, the clock ticks, and one day we will die. But what Jesus has done is not simply stopped the clock. He's not simply given us a chance of immortality. What he has done is given us an offer of glory. We shall reign with Jesus if we subject ourselves to him and become children of God. By faith in Jesus, Jesus is going to lift us higher than the distance we fell in Adam. Failure in the garden means that everything is the wrong way around. This may be controversial, but Adam was meant to teach Eve. He was meant to teach her everything that he knew about God. Instead, Eve taught Adam. They were meant to rule over the animals, but instead a talking snake told them what to do. They were meant to trust God for all that they didn't know. But they abandoned that position of trust with God. They chose their own way, which turned out to be humiliation, a curse, hard work, shame, and death. Peace was taken from the earth. Authority was separated from love. And life became a struggle. All because, in a sense, our father Adam gave up the dignity of being subject to God alone and made himself subject to sin and to death. So now men and women really are not fit to rule. And if you read the first 11 chapters of Genesis, you see a series of tragedies that follow on as a result of losing our proper position in the universe. As Romans says, God has subjected the whole of creation to futility as a result of men and women losing their proper place in creation. A and they're no longer fit to rule. This is why politics always fail. Nobody is really fit to rule anymore. We are unworthy men. I came across a poem the other day written by Seamus Heaney called The Republic of Conscience. It's a really good poem, but it is poignant because it points out that actually we do not live by conscience as we should. I'm going to read out a couple of lines. At their inauguration, public leaders must swear to uphold unwritten law and weep to atone for their presumption to hold office. Can we read that again? Is it a bit complicated? At their inauguration, public leaders must swear to uphold unwritten law. In other words, not just the laws that exist, but they must actually live by their consciences. And they should weep to atone for their presumption to hold office. I've seen that politicians get a bit teary-eyed when they lose an election. But the idea that a man should weep because he presumes to rule over other people is a very interesting idea, isn't it? If only men's consciences were that strong, politics would take a different shape. But our problem is that once we refuse to be responsible to God, we can't even be responsible to one another. If we refuse to love our ruler, then we cannot rule in love. Death is necessary for sinners. It would be a terrible thing if human beings were immortal. We are simply not worthy of immortality as we are without the grace of God. I was thinking about this dentist who shot a lion, and I was thinking, well, here we are, we've got very few lions left in the world, and here we have wealthy men who've got enough money to travel across the world just so that they can take a photograph of themselves with the corpse of a dead male lion. And I thought, how far we have fallen. We were meant to be the custodians and the keepers of this world. And yet, we are the main destroyers. There have been a huge number of extinctions of animals. I was hearing about the extinction of horses in Britain in ancient times. The archaeologists suspect that the reason horses became extinct was because humans ate them all. And there's a long and rather embarrassing history of, instead of looking after the creation, of, if you like, abusing and destroying God's creation. Until there comes a point where one of the angels in the book of Revelation says, the time has come to destroy those who destroy the earth. We should have been the rulers. We should have been the responsible rulers. We should have been the loving rulers of creation. And what have we become? We have become the despoilers of the earth. But in the story of Adam and Eve, there is one thing which I think is the point of the whole story, really. The point of the story is that God doesn't actually kill the man and woman straight away. He makes them subjects of death, but he doesn't kill them. And he promises them that one of the children of the woman would crush the snake's head. He would kill the snake. And of course, the son of Eve, who actually is doing that and is going to do that, is the Lord Jesus Christ. And after all of that sin, after death reigning from then until now, the Christian hope is precisely this, that we shall be given a greater dignity and a greater standing with God than Adam lost. For we shall reign with Jesus Christ. We shall be co-heirs with Christ of the new creation. Think about all those parables Jesus told. If you're faithful with a little, he says, then you will be trusted with much. If you're able to look after a little bit of gold or silver, one day you will rule over cities. Most of Jesus' parables are about the time when there will be this great reversal, and we who are subjects of death, often also subjects of wicked men, often subjects of our own bad tendencies, we will reign with Jesus Christ. So we are meant to rule. That will require a great change. That will require the Holy Spirit to change us inside out. That will require a deep transformation. It will require us being changed from one degree of glory to another. It will require this body being sown in weakness, sown in dishonor, and then raised to glory and to power and to holiness. Or, if we're alive when Jesus returns, it will require us being radically changed, clothed with immortality, cleansed of all unrighteousness, totally equipped and fitted to rule with Jesus in the world that is to come. So, what everything I've said so far, you probably know. You know that this is the destiny of those who are called to follow Jesus. We are called one day to reign. But what I want to point out is that in Romans 5, it doesn't say that we shall reign in the future. It seems that we are meant to reign in life, at least to some extent, now. And that works out in various ways. If you are being prepared by God to be his regent over all of creation, to be a brother or sister of Jesus in the world that is coming, to sit with him on his throne, then even in this life, we are meant to be changing. Even now, we are meant to, at least to some extent, reign in love. We are meant to, in some ways, be changing something, at least a little bit, into the image of what Christ intends us to be. And I think the first thing is this. I think that we are meant to reign over our own little kingdom. Now, what is your little kingdom? What is your sphere of authority? I would suggest to you that the first and obvious thing is your own body, your own life. We are meant to live differently because we are destined to reign with Jesus. So, for instance, before conversion, we may well have been subject to desires, to temptations, to fears that ruled us. We are meant now to start taking responsibility for our lives and start ruling over our little sphere of authority, our own bodies, our own lives, our own day-to-day existence. Nina Simone, you're all too young to know who Nina Simone is, probably, eh? Yeah, sorry. Okay. This is for the old folks. The young ones can pass on this. Nina Simone, great song. I've got life, yeah? She says, I haven't got anything. I've got no looks, I've got no money, got no style. What has she got? She's got her hands, her feet, her heads, her head, her nose. She's got her body, she's got life. That is your little empire. Your body, your life. This is where you are meant to start ruling with Jesus Christ, where you are meant to be changed from one degree of glory to another as you behold his face. Yes, you do have an empire. It's an empire of organs and bones, an empire of skin and teeth, an empire of hair, well, some of us, and other bits and pieces as well. This is what God has given you. This is your life. Are you reigning? Are you reigning in life over your own existence? This is why the last fruit of the Holy Spirit that is mentioned is self-control. Christians, by the grace of the Holy Spirit, by the forgiveness of Jesus, are meant to be learning self-control. You may not rule over much, but you do have a life. And in this life, we are meant at least to start reigning. To start living for Jesus, living for what is good, living under a renewed conscience, and living a new life. So Romans 12 says, no, don't be conformed any longer to the pattern of this age, because this age is dying. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, by the work of God's Holy Spirit, by the work of God's Word, changing your consciousness so that you begin to rule in love. I don't think we're ready to rule Britain. Whenever churches try to govern the world, it becomes a huge mistake and embarrassment. We are not ready to rule the world. But one place we are ready to rule is in the church itself. I noticed that in 1 Corinthians, for instance, when Christians are taking each other to court, the challenge is to sort out the mess inside the church. This can't always be done, but where it can be done, we are meant to take responsibility. The argument there seems to have been an argument over money. And so the challenge is, Paul says, do you not realize one day you will judge angels? One day you will rule over creation. In the meantime, can you please rule over yourselves? Can you please sort this out? He says, even appoint the least of you. You don't even need to involve the elders and deacons if you don't want to. Just appoint whoever you think is least. I think he might be sort of putting them to shame, embarrassing a little bit with that. But what he's saying is, look, one day God is going to trust you with a huge amount of authority. In the meantime, the church should be able to sort out its problems. In the same way, they had a particularly nasty case of immorality, which they were sort of either not talking about or even saying, well, there you are, but you have to be broad-minded. No, he says, no, you have to take action here. The church has to discipline itself. Why? Because we are meant to rule in love. We are meant to be people who are being remade in the image and in the likeness of Jesus Christ. The church can make hard judgments. In Revelation 2, the church of Thyatira is challenged to discipline people who are dominating in the church, a so-called prophet. And we're also given authority to encourage, build up, and support one another. Ephesians 4 says the whole church is equipped to build each other up in love. So yes, we can reign in love. It is true that we are not yet what we will be. It is true that we're not immortal. We're not yet as wise or as good as we shall be. But we can reign in life. And I think that is why in Romans 5 it says death reigned. Because of Adam. But because of Jesus, we shall reign.
Amen.